I started my research in the mid-80s on neural networks. I got very excited when I started reading papers on this topic, and it's been my passion since then. Too many projects. I'm one of my pet projects right now, which is not in the mainstream of what's going on in deep learning, is trying to bridge the gap between deep learning and neuroscience, at least at the level that I care about of neuroscience, that is understanding underlying principles from a mathematical point of view, from a machine learning point of view, that could explain how brains learn, and not just what's happening in a single neuron, but how what happens in single neurons connected together gives rise to the kind of complex learning that we see in our systems. Because right now there's no good theory, really. Other areas, many things. I care a lot about pushing deep learning beyond the traditional realm of pattern recognition, where it started, into things that are sort of more high-level cognition, abstract understanding, reasoning, natural language understanding, things like that. Well, that's more for the business people to figure that out. But clearly, one thing that I decided recently would be something I wanted to invest more time on are the medical applications. I think there's a huge potential. Of course, there are social issues for sharing the data properly, but the potential of helping lots of people is huge. Then all the work we're doing with natural language understanding and computer vision could really transform the way we interact with computers. That's going to change everybody's life, very likely, in the next few years. I'm sure there are many other applications that people will find by exploring how these can be used. Depends on non-technical matters. About the data. Can we be changing the system fast enough that scientists, either in companies or in academia, can get their hands on large enough quantities of data to start being able to do useful things? That's really one of the crucial elements. I think in terms of the science, we can take what we already have and do good engineering with that data and already be very, very useful for many medical problems. Well, yeah, it's clearly a risk. It's almost a certainty. And it's going to depend on how we organize, again, socially, politically, to deal with those changes. In terms of, making sure that we don't leave it to the law of the jungle and take care of the people who lose their job. In terms of other risks, there's, of course, the military risk. I've signed this letter asking governments to take steps to avoid arms race using AI for military weapons. Other things that I'm worried about include in kind of a short term horizon include the use of these technologies in advertising. I think it could right now we think sometimes, oh, it's a bit creepy, but when those machine learning systems used for advertising become much more powerful at understanding us and our desires, it becomes a little bit of like if they were manipulating us, and under some threshold, we'll probably we're okay. But I think at some point, people will start thinking this is not okay. Think about how this could be used to manipulate people with political advertising, right? So there's already political advertising, and I don't like it. And most people think, oh, well, it's not going to change my mind. But actually, it does. Otherwise, people wouldn't spend, you know, those billions of dollars. But when those technologies become smarter, I think it becomes more, you know, worrisome that money is basically going to buy democracy. One that I really focus on is unsupervised learning. As you may have heard, right now we are very good at training these systems when we can tell the computer, okay, so for this case you should output this value, for this case you should say this, for this case you should do that. And we need millions of such cases. But humans are able to learn without, you know, having to take them by hand all the time. For example, a two-year-old learns about the physics of the world just by observing and interacting with the world. You know, parents don't tell their children, you know, force equals mass times acceleration, be careful. So we have that ability, and it's really important for our intelligence, very probably. It would be also important in terms of applications, because there's a lot of data out there that doesn't come with a human interpretation that says, okay, so in this image, there's this, there's that, and in this document, this is what the person said, and this is the meaning of this word, and blah, blah, blah. And it's a never-ending task to try to label everything for the computer to know how to interpret examples. This is how we do it now. And so we need ways to make machine learning more autonomous. But this is really what unsupervised learning is about. Read my book. It should be coming out in a few months. I've been told September. It's meant exactly for people who want to get into the field. And I'm speaking of people, say, with some technical background, like computer science or physics or math or something like that. And there are a lot of resources out there. There's a lot of code. I encourage people to go and play with these libraries and play with the data and you know, read papers. There's tons of literature. There are videos, lectures, the book that we're putting out, which is already available online, you know, in chapters. So there's enough to get started for many people already, if to just take the time to do it. Thank you.